Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
All right. We welcome you this morning. Our first announcement, you may have noticed, Edwin's not here. We welcome Kate Paulson Connors as our guest preacher today. We are grateful to have her here to share the word. Our next announcement, there is an all-important trustees meeting today at 12:30. So all trustees, please don't run away. You have a meeting. You have two more weeks this week and next week to get your poinsettia orders in. So please, please, please get your poinsettia orders in. And we don't have an official minute for hope this week, but we did want to announce we have about 11,000 to go, so we're nearing the end of our stewardship campaign. If you have not already gotten your pledge cards in, please do get your pledge cards in so that we can finish the year strong and close out our stewardship campaign. And before we move on to our greetings, our last announcement, we would ask, as is our tradition at Hope Church, when we lose a member of our church, we do have a ritual where we stand and have a moment of silence for them. And sadly, we lost a member, Ann Lindsay, so we ask that everyone in the congregation please rise. Ann passed away in hospice after a long illness. She was a very kind woman and a lover of animals, and she was a wonderful spirit to have. So we ask that you take a moment of silence to remember our dear friend, Ann Lindsay. We ask that God be with her two daughters as they mourn her passing as well. You may be seated. Well, you may be seated for a moment. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad.
And may the peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pass the peace. Thank you. Please join me in our call to worship. In the season of waiting, our God comes.
Come suddenly, Holy God, into our slow expectations and fill us with your urgent hopes for justice.
In this holy season of delight and wonder, our Savior comes.
Come suddenly, companion of the poor, and challenge us to share in the gospel of welcome for all.
In these days of remembering what our lives are to be, our spirit comes.
Come suddenly, preparer of the way, to take us by the hand, to walk with our sisters and brothers down the path to service.
The peace candle has been lit. For the peace prayer today, I've prepared something a little bit different for Advent. In the season of Advent, I've challenged myself with something really difficult. At home, I've been meditating on Matthew 5:44, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. I think it's probably the most challenging part of the Bible. It's probably the most challenging thing that Jesus has ever asked us to do, is to pray for, to love our enemies and pray for those who persecute us. And I've been thinking about what that means, who our enemies are and who I consider my enemy to be, because I don't really think of us as having direct enemies. But I've been thinking about the most hated and the most sort of terrible people in our culture, in our community. And so I've decided every day of Advent to pray for people like Dylann Roof, you know, the people who have committed terrible crimes against our communities, and to pray for their victims. So I've written a prayer today for Gregory Bowers, the Tree of Life synagogue shooter, and his victims. So I ask that you pray with me today. Dear Lord, in this season of Advent, we prepare for the coming of your Son in an ever-broken world. You have commanded us to pray for that broken world. We watch as individuals filled with hate seek to destroy innocent people. You command us to love them anyway. And so we attempt with your help, O Lord, to obey. Lord, we pray for the soul of Robert Gregory Bowers. We pray for him to feel the touch of your spirit and to understand what it means to be your beloved child and to be forgiven. We do not seek to excuse or ignore the evil he has done, but instead we lift up this prayer because we believe that love and kindness are the disruptors of hate. The loving kindness that flows from you, O Lord. While we lift up one hand to pray for our enemies, Lord, we lift up the other to bind up the brokenhearted. We pray for the souls of Joyce Feinberg, Richard Gottfried, Rose Malinger, Jerry Rabinowitz, Cecil Rosenthal, David Rosenthal, Bernice Simon, Sylvan Simon, David Stein, Melvin Wax, and Irvin Younger. Be with their loved ones. Help them to heal, comfort them as they grieve. Remind us, O Lord, that fear is the true enemy of peace. Help us to be courageous about loving those who seek to hate. And remind us that we can do all things in the name of your Son, the Prince of Peace. In his name, in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Let us continue our worship by singing hymn number 82, Come Thou Long Expected. We will now have the lighting of the First Advent candle.
On this day, we bear witness to the light of Christ with all the faithful in every time and place. In Isaiah and Jeremiah, prophets of Israel, we await the promised salvation of the Lord and look for the coming of the one who will bring justice and righteousness to the earth. The Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen His glory.
We have all sinned, and we have all fallen short of the glory of God. But we believe in a God who forgives even the worst of our sins. Let us say together the prayer of confession and be forgiven.
You witness the source of lives we lead, approach to God. Ask to share the gospel of hope. You place it on our to-do list instead. You give it the chance to cry out for justice for others. We are all strangely silent. Invited to pray with joy in every moment. We prefer to grumble about every insignificant thing in our lives. Have mercy on us, God of grace, and prepare our hearts for your forgiveness and have its way in them. Fill us with your hope so we might lighten the shadows of others. Help us to join choirs of children in singing of your joy. Transform us to that tender mercy who is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
God is our witness. We have spoken of our lives and been forgiven of every mistake we have made, every hurt we have caused.
We are held in God's heart, not only on this day, but all the days of our lives. Thanks be to God.
The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. In those days and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved and Jerusalem will live in safety. And this is the name by which it will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
heard in that awesome anthem. Thank you so much. That was wonderful. From the 22nd chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, verses 34 through 40. Listen now for how God is speaking to us today. When the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, asked Jesus a question to test him. "Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest?" He said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment, and a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to
God. Let us pray. Holy God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. For a lot of my life, I did not understand what it really meant to love God. What does it look like when someone loves God? It always seemed like an abstract concept. Now, I'm a child of the church. I went to Sunday school every week. My parents are both elders and have served on the session of a church in North Carolina where I grew up many times. So I know very deeply that I'm supposed to love God. I've known that since I was born. But I've had a hard time really understanding what that looks like. What does that mean? Does it look like someone who prays every day or someone who tithes? Does it look like someone who attends worship every week? Does it look like someone who reads scripture every day? Or who serves on every possible church committee? Or who says grace before every meal? And I would probably still be trying to figure out, what does this abstract concept look like, if I hadn't followed a call 7.5 years ago into the wonderful and challenging and incredibly holy ministry of the Center. The Center is a mission initiative of the Presbytery of Baltimore, and I am the director. It was founded by a group of pastors and lay leaders, including myself, who came together about 9 years ago to dream about creating an urban mission center in Baltimore. We met monthly for about 18 months, and a few things were clear from the very beginning of our conversations. All of our churches were getting several calls a year from church groups from all over the country who were coming to Baltimore for mission trips, and they wanted to know if they could stay on the floors of our Sunday school classrooms. And by the way, do you have showers? And do you have any idea what we can do while we're there? Some of our churches were willing to open the Sunday school rooms to these groups. None of our churches had showers, and we only knew of a couple usual suspects to send them to, organizations that were large and well-known, so Habitat for Humanity or Our Daily Bread, which is a hot meal program. So as we shared these stories that were very similar, we realized there was really a need for something like this, and that there was an opportunity, perhaps, to help these groups have a more meaningful experience of mission in our presbytery. We really discerned over these 18 months that God was calling our presbytery to start something new. So during these conversations over that year and a half that we met, we talked a lot about mission. And we've learned that many of us, most of us actually, had been on mission trips that had left us feeling kind of uncomfortable when we went home. Trips where we had gone into somebody else's country or somebody else's city or somebody else's neighborhood. Often where we had built something for them or painted a wall for them, not really knowing what we were doing. And really, would you want a 16-year-old coming and repairing your house, fixing your roof, painting your house? It was kind of odd once we started thinking about this. So we didn't want to create something like that, where groups would come in and do something for someone that may or may not be needed, that would require skills they didn't have. We wanted to create something different that would build on a different dynamic. So we created this initiative called The Center, and it really was built around one person's suggestion in a meeting. And his suggestion was this: what if when these groups come in to Baltimore, we provide a place for them to stay, and we partner them with local congregations that are engaged in their own neighborhoods with their neighbors, doing whatever it is they've decided together would strengthen the neighborhood. And this way, the groups can come in and plug into something that local leaders are leading year-round and have decided is the most important thing to do in their neighborhood. So in this model, these groups come from all over the country, and they're all ages 12 up through 85, I think we've got an 85-year-old. They come in for mission experiences, for a weekend, for a week, or some combination of days that works for them. And they get to serve alongside a local congregation that's engaged in its neighborhood in some kind of ministry. Our groups have served with churches that are feeding the hungry, churches that run after-school programs with children in their neighborhood who don't go to school, churches that have adopted a neighborhood and are involved in strengthening the whole neighborhood in numerous ways, churches that are involved with renovating housing, providing safe summer experiences for neighborhood children, or supporting senior adults in the neighborhood. And it is through this ministry at the center, right here in our presbytery, that I have really learned what it means to love God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. And when I was looking at this passage this week, preparing to be with you this morning, I noticed something that I had never paid attention to before. If you keep reading past that first part that is so familiar to many of us, there's a second part, right? There's a second commandment. There's this little part in between. So the first part we heard, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. And then he says, Jesus says, a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. So there's this little part in between those two commandments. Did you catch it? A second is like it. The first commandment is that we love God. And the second is like it, that we love our neighbor. Jesus is telling the Pharisee that loving God means loving our neighbor, that loving our neighbor is like loving God. And I have seen so many good people in our presbytery loving their neighbor these past 7 years. People in Baltimore City, people in Towson, people in Glen Burnie, in Annapolis, in Baltimore County, various locations. I've seen so many good folks loving their neighbors. I've seen Precious, who is a woman in recovery from opioid addiction, who now works in a methadone-assisted opioid addiction treatment and counseling center. I watched Precious start an urban garden across the street from the counseling center, a garden that is a sanctuary for neighborhood kids, a source of fresh vegetables for a neighborhood that is located in a food desert, and a place for people in recovery to heal and reflect. The center has brought many groups of volunteers, middle schoolers through adults, to serve alongside Precious and other neighborhood leaders. And they have cleared land, pulled weeds, planted seeds, and harvested vegetables. They have helped Precious and the program and the garden for sure. But they have also learned and witnessed firsthand the tremendous power of a tiny garden to transform a neighborhood. I've seen five churches collaborate in that same very distressed neighborhood, working with a community organizer and the neighborhood association to create safe and fun summer camps for neighborhood children. Camps where they learn the stories of Jesus, where they get to play kickball, where they get to make art, where they receive healthy meals during the summer months when many of them go hungry. I've seen 14-year-old boys sitting on the floor and reading books with children who have no books at home. I've seen college students from one of the wealthiest and one of the whitest towns in New England playing basketball with African-American teens on a public school playground in West Baltimore, and the laughter was joyous. I've seen middle schoolers and adults cook Thanksgiving side dishes with homeless young mothers while some of the volunteers watched their children for a while. I've seen suburban moms laughing and dancing jazzercise with city kids in a second floor classroom of a Baltimore City public school building. And 3 weeks ago, I sat around a table in an upstairs room of a bilingual Spanish-English church with a mission committee from Charlotte, North Carolina, who was taking part in a mission weekend at the center. We sat around the table in that upstairs room and broke bread with two immigrant pastors from Colombia, South America, who shared their story of having to flee the country after their lives and their children's lives were threatened by one of the drug cartels there. I could tell so many stories about people loving their neighbor, people stepping outside their church buildings and into their neighborhoods and building relationships with the people who live next door. Through these stories and so many more stories that I could tell, I finally understand what it looks like to love God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. Jesus says it right there in Matthew 22, but I had always skipped over the beginning of that second sentence, the one that starts with, and a second is like it. To love God is to love your neighbor. To love your neighbor is to love God. And like so much of this life of faith that we have all been called to, loving your neighbor is really hard work. I have seen that in all of these places where the center takes me and our volunteers. It is messy, it is unpredictable, and it requires you to show up, not just once, but regularly. Show up in someone else's neighborhood with humility and curiosity and love. And it requires that you just listen for a little while. Listen for what God is already doing in that place. Because God is already in those countries where our churches have gone for so long and built things for people. God is already there. God is already in our neighborhoods. God is already in the communities all around us. And God is doing wondrous things. We just have to look a little more closely to see what God is up to. When we show up in the community, when we build relationships with our neighbors, when we leave our building and head out to the streets with our neighbors, not just one time, but many, many times over a long period of time, long enough to learn our neighbors' names, to find out what they care about, to find out what their biggest pressures are, to listen to their dreams for their children and for their neighborhood. This is how we learn what it means to love God. And so this Advent, as we prepare for God to come into our midst yet again in the most unexpected way, as we prepare our hearts once again to receive God's gift of love entering our world, and as we prepare to love God right back with all our heart and all our soul and all our mind, let us prepare as well by loving our neighbors with humility and curiosity and boldness. Amen. of the Nicene Creed.
We believe in one God, Father, the Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven and was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified and launched his pilot. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge us the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
You may be seated. We have spent so much time and energy trying to find the right card, a special present, a perfect gift to offer others. But like our God, all anyone wants from us is our grace, our hope, our joy, and our love. Let us stop worrying and, like Mary, set out on the journey to God's heart, where we can offer ourselves, as well as our gifts, in this moment. Let us now bring forth our tithes and offerings. Thank you. book this morning. One is from Pat Boyce. She asked for prayers for her friend Melissa and her two teenage boys. Her husband died suddenly last Tuesday of a massive heart attack. And from Landy, asking for prayers for my friend Yeji Yoon. She was diagnosed with stage 3 breast cancer. She is in her 30s and recently married. Thank you both for sharing those concerns. Let us pray. Holy God, as we enter this season of waiting, of preparing for you to once again come into our midst, we come before you as we wait with so much on our hearts. We come with gratitude for the many blessings in our lives. But we also come with heavy hearts. God, we pray for this world, where there is so much brokenness and so much need. God, we pray for the humanitarian crisis in Yemen, for the thousands who are going hungry there. We pray for those countries that are dealing with natural disasters, particularly Indonesia, as they continue to deal with devastation from earthquake and tsunami. We pray for France, where there are massive protests happening that are becoming violent. God, we lift up all these places and so many more that need your love, that need your justice. God, we lift up our own country, especially today, Alaska, in the aftermath of the earthquake, and also those states in the southeast, particularly North Carolina and Florida, as they continue to rebuild after hurricanes. God, we lift up our own community. We ask that you hold this neighborhood and the wider Baltimore metro area. There is so much to pray about in this city. And God, we pray for those who today are dealing with difficult news, those who are sick, those who are grieving. We especially lift up to you Landy's friend Yeji, as she finds out and deals with and moves forward with this diagnosis of breast cancer. We pray for Yeji and for her new spouse, that they might find you in the hands of those who are caring for them in the medical community, and also through their family and friends. God, we pray for Melissa and for her teenage sons as they grieve a very unexpected death. May they know your love through their friends and their family that surrounds them during this time of deep grief. God, we pray for the family and friends of President George H.W. Bush as they too grieve his death this week. We thank you for his service to our country and ask that you comfort all those who mourn his passing. God, we lift up to you this first day of Advent, all of those for whom the holiday season is hard. This is a season of great joy, but it can also be a season full of sadness for some. We pray that they might feel your love, your care, and your peace through friends and family who help them through this difficult time of year. God, we pray all of these things in the name of your Son, the Prince. Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Friends, we are invited to this table by the God of Israel, who is gracious and merciful, who is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. This is the table where all of our work for a better life and a fairer world is blessed, and where we are nurtured and magnified together in the common struggle that God began and that God will finish in time to come. This is not a Presbyterian table, it is the table of our Lord. And Christ invites all of those who wish to follow him to feast here together. Let us pray. God, we give you thanks. You set us in this world to love and serve you and to live in peace with all that you have made. We ask that you pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be a communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Holy Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we might be one with all who share this feast and united in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. And now, God, hear us as we pray together the words that your Son Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
In the week that he was anointed by Mary, and on the night that he was arrested, our Lord Jesus sat at table with his disciples, and he took bread, and he broke it. He blessed it first, and he broke it. And he gave it to them, saying, Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this, remembering me. And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, This is the cup of the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this, remembering me. Friends, every time we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim the saving life, death, and resurrection of our Lord until he comes. These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
as your child, who is the true bread from heaven and the food of eternal life. Keep our conduct blameless, keep our hearts watchful in holiness, and bring to perfection the good that you have begun in each of us. In the name of Him whose coming is certain, whose day draws near, your child, the Prince of Peace, our Lord and our brother, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Not just in this building, but outside as well.
For to love our neighbor is also to love God. And may the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you, and among you, and between you, this day, and every day of your gifted life.